Welcome to another great episode of Classic Wrestling from Florida. My friend, great co-host Randy Savage, the Macho Man himself.
Woo, yeah!
Former partner, went to school together, grew up together, Steve Keirn. Steve, I'm glad you're here with us
I'm
today.
I'm glad you stumbled over that friend part with Randy. You got to keep your eye on him.
You know, I noticed that. It was a little hesitation right there. I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt.
My brain is so teeny and I have so many matches to try to remember.
That's a good excuse.
Right now, we're getting ready to see
friend.
Billy Jack Haynes, his first match that he had when he came to Florida, wrestling against Wild Bill Snyder. The match doesn't last too long, but it's very intense, and it shows the muscles and the strength that Billy Jack had. And a surprise person comes out and welcomes him to the...
I know who that is.
I don't.
Well, don't
you're just
say
have
it
to
yet.
Watch this part right here, and then you're going to recognize him. I guarantee it. You're going to be so excited when we come out here. You're going to think, I should have known that.
Yeah, we'll see about that.
Time limit. Introducing first from Portland, Oregon, at 255 pounds, the Pacific Coast heavyweight champion, Billy Jack. His opponent from the Great Northwest Territory, at 220 pounds, Wild Bill Snyder.
Snyder started to charge Billy Jack, and Billy Jack just hooked him very neatly, body, full body slam. A drop kick, another flying drop kick. Billy Jack, 6'3", 255 pounds, Pacific Coast champion, powerlifting champion. Look at this, full body press, way up over the head, and a full slam from about 8 feet up in the air. Wild Bill, and he's got the full Nelson. He's got the rough.
Gordon, in most cases, the full Nelson is just a softening up hole, but it looks like with that upper body strength, did you see that? Did you see that with a full Nelson just annihilated him?
Man, oh man, oh man, is that Billy Jack something else? And look who's just stepped in the ring. The American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And there you have it. Billy Jack and Dusty Rhodes. What a combination. We'll try and get an interview with Billy Jack a little later. Now here's the man that we've all been waiting to hear from, the incomparable Billy Jack.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen of the great state of Florida. I'm Billy Jack. I'm the current Pacific Coast heavyweight champion. During my stay here, I hope to meet, I don't care, black, white, green, purple, blue, all you beautiful people here. I'd like to meet you. I'll wrestle any man here in Florida, anytime, any place. It's a pleasure meeting the great Dusty Rhodes, the all-American dream, baby. We'll see you. Peace.
Who was the fat guy with a mark on his belly?
Dude, I know it was Dusty Rhodes. Oh, all right, man. I thought it was going to be something tricky, but it wasn't, man. I was sitting right here.
Oh, like
I knew you would know.
Anyway,
You called me a liar?
No way. We're getting ready to see Kendall Nagasaki versus Kendall Windham in a boxing match. Gloves on boxing.
Oh, like Brian Adams.
No, he started, but he didn't get into
Kendall it. Kendall had a match.
And I was lying.
Don't go away. Welcome back to another exciting segment of Classic Wrestling from Florida. You're going to see a young man from a wrestling family, Kendall Windham, brother of Barry Windham, son of Black Jack Mulligan, brother-in-law to Mike Rotundo, surrounded with wrestlers, and he's in a boxing match against Kendo Nagasaki, who's a martial arts expert.
Who'd figure?
Where this came from, I don't know, but you never know what you're going to see on this show.
Kendo boxing wrestling style, that's all you're going to see?
No. What I was going to say is, why didn't the Windhams take their dad's wrestling name, Mulligan? I don't understand that, because Blackjack paved the way for him.
Yeah, but probably they didn't want him to, but just like with Angelo Papa with me, I changed my last name because we didn't want to do it.
Maybe we'll get him on the show and ask him. But anyway,
my dad didn't want me to have my name.
Wrestling match right now.
I'm going to call my dad a phone and see if you're right.
Kendall Windham, Kendall Nagasaki.
Now, we had mentioned we have a special treat for you, and this had to do with a particular match with Kendall Windham against Kendo Nagasaki. If we can, let's take a look at this right now. It involves, as I said, Kendall Windham, and here it is, a boxing match, and joining me also at the desk is Kendall Windham. Kendall, as you can see right now, taking a couple of licks from Kendo Nagasaki.
This was a match, again, where maybe I could talk over a little better. Kendo Nagasaki agreed to a full-contact karate match with the boxing gloves, but the kicking and elbows, back fists, and all that sort of thing were legal. These are the kind of gloves they use in that match, and this match had been going on for some time. Kendall using basically a boxing style was giving Kendall Nagasaki all he could handle. I mean, tearing into him. You can see it here. He's pounding him good in the corner.
A lot of combinations there with the left and the right.
Well, look at Kendall. He's not charging aggressively out of that corner, I guess you could say. And he gained a lot of respect. The hands of the master are trained with the chopping edge of the fist and the knuckles.
Well, the feet, as you see right there.
Well, as long as Kendall Windham could avoid those feet, he had a real good, I think, better hand work in terms of with the gloves on. Those hands aren't hardened, soaked in brine, and chop. Karate mentality of Kendo Nagasaki, a lot of handwork, chopping blocks, toughening up the hands. He is deadly with them, but in the gloves, this was because Kendall wouldn't go in this kind of match, I don't think, unless he had an idea of going to a karate match. He was willing to take a chance. And now again, here, watch this. He's just pounding him into pudding. And Kendo Nagasaki is obviously very, you see him holding his jaw there. He's looking like a loser, and he's also looking kind of frustrated there.
Yeah, he's been seeing up close and personal, like the tips of the boxing gloves of Kendall too often.
He's backing up now. He's very wary. As this match goes on, you'll see it becomes even worse for Kendo Nagasaki. Kendall takes a couple, but Kendall's not a boxer per se. He's a chopper and a thruster, and here he's just opening up with a ground.
Good left hook there.
Those left, right, left, right, left. Kendall with that left-handed style has a different approach. Again, coming from the left side, and that left hook is the same thing as a right cross, and he's knocked Kendall Nagasaki down again. At this point, Kendall Nagasaki is trying to go for that kendo stick. With the box, you can see it laying over in the corner, but with the boxing gloves, he couldn't get it on. He couldn't get pick up the stick, so he took off the gloves. That's where the match, he was disqualified here. But you can see, he could not handle, in his kind of match, it's full contact karate, he could not handle Kendall Windham. And he had to pull the gloves off, and again, go for that kendo stick.
It just once again shows that the shock troops, along with Sir Oliver Humperdinck, in their mind, they're going to do whatever it takes to beat Kendall Windham, or anyone for that matter, and that's exactly what they did.
Well, Kendall's here to join us. Kendall, you got a couple words to say.
He's got his breath back. What kind of comments you have to say about that particular match?
Well, Mr. Root, Mr. Rhodes, you know, I wouldn't have even touched Humperdinck, but he interfered into a match. I proved right there that I think that I can beat Kendo Nagasaki. And Ron Bass, I just want to tell you, you interfered in a match. And wherever I get you, I guarantee you I'm going to knock you out. Same goes for you, Kendo Nagasaki.
Well, during the break, a very interesting topic came up that these guys have been debating since you were gone.
It's not a debate. He's just telling me the way he feels,
family.
And he's wrong.
See, his dad didn't want to use his name.
My dad was Eddie Graham.
I wrestled
with
Mike Graham.
Randy had made something about why Mulligan, and you said Barry Windham and all that.
Randy wrestled as Randy Savage's father, Poffo.
Yeah, so he made a knock that my dad didn't make his name because I would embarrass my dad.
No, that's what you said. Your dad said you would embarrass him.
Oh, did he really?
Yeah. Oh, get him on the phone.
I will.
All right.
He loves this show. He loves this show.
His dad said, I don't want him to use the name. Kid, you ruin it.
Huh.
He let Lanny use the name, didn't he?
Yeah.
Okay, well, see, favoritism towards your brother.
Right. That's
true. If you'd had a brother, he wouldn't have been able to use Graham.
Well, how do you know Randy Savage isn't my real name anyway? Why, because they told you
different? Because I saw it on your driver's license.
Don't go away. This conversation I know is going to continue for the rest of the time. We'll be right back.
It's actually Randy Savage.
Well, welcome back, and tell you right now, our friend, business associate, all that kind of stuff, Dusty Rhodes, did an interview for us to put on the show from another set, and he's talking about life and his thing in the wrestling business and the first time he wins the world's heavyweight title. Very interesting, very down-to-earth, sincere interview from Dusty Rhodes.
Is he talking about you two?
No, he's talking about himself and his life and winning the world's
title.
Well,
before I'm checking it out right here, I'll take a chance and say this is really, really, really cool that he did that. Of course, if he knocks me,
it ain't going to be so cool.
No, it's not going to be so cool. Then it's going to be cold.
Nah. He doesn't knock anybody.
Good. Well, I think this is cool.
Is the classic Dusty Rhodes guy.
That's
did
great.
The right kind of interview. Was just glad to be a part of this. Wishes everyone well. And he's got some interesting things to say.
Well, then I wish him well, too. Not you, him.
Well, I'm excited about seeing it. Let's play it.
All right.
Well, I'm kind of hoping he knocks you now.
But there's a lot of stuff left to come. We still got Carl Cox. We've still got the Missouri Mauler. We've still got Pak Song Nam, the guy that I used to watch take his bare hands and break bricks until his hands would bleed, break his fingers, and he'd take that same hand and pound me on the noggin.
Huh. I'm really excited about seeing Killer Carl Cox because I wrestled him in one of my early matches, and he took care of me. He was a cool dude, not so like you.
Great guys coming on the show yet today, so don't go away. Stay here, watch some cool wrestling.
I already knew I wasn't cool.
I just threw him by.
Don't go away.
You know, sitting at home, I bet many times you say, boy, what's it like to be down there at the Super Bowl when the game is over and everybody runs down there or to be a heavyweight fighter like Evander Holyfield? What's it like a George Foreman to be in the corner, Muhammad Ali, when the titles are won? What's that like? You're in a big boat racing, you know, and you're winning boats like my main man, Mike Graham, drives these boats to a hellish speeds. What's it like to win one of them things? What's that emotion that goes through you? Well, let me tell you, it's the most unbelievable rush you could ever feel. And I felt that rush for the first time when I became World Heavyweight Champion in Tampa, Florida, in the armory in Harley Race. And that jubilation still today just give me chills when I think about it. But we're going to show you something really special. Not a lot of eyes have seen this piece of film or tape nowadays, they call it, or really history is what I call it, tradition. Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, in a jubilant locker room with all his fans and friends, and this thing that you only live like one time in your life. You'll be world champion again, maybe, but that first one is so special, just like the Super Bowl or anything else. Go with me now back to that locker room scene as I became the world heavyweight champion.
We're fired with everybody. All right.
All right.
All right. Yeah. 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 It's been a long time coming, but I told you it's going to happen. This is an example for every man, woman, and child. Every one of my children can look right now. Dream of a dream. Have a dream. Have a way to get it. I'm not going to stumble my words like Terry Funk did when he won the title. I'm telling you, get a dream. Hold on to it and shoot for the sky. Because now excitement. Remember, I have been to the mountaintop, and it will take a hell of a man to knock me off. This is your call.
Hey, Randy, I told you, he was nice about everything. He's glad to be a part of this show.
Cool. I wasn't oversensitive to it. I was just thinking that the great American dream, Dusty Rhodes, watching this program, that's a cool situation. So props to you, Dusty Rhodes, and thanks for not knocking me.
Hey, Dusty is a good guy. Has his moments like we all do. But anyway, enough said about that.
I don't have any moments.
We've got a great show, and coming up in the last segment here, we've got some names that are unbelievable. Killer Carl Cox.
I like him, Killer.
Always talking to Alex.
That was a really great one.
Sonny Myers, who back in the 50s was a great wrestler that came back as a referee, and then with a certain thing wound up in this particular match.
Hey, he had part of a finger missing, didn't he, Sonny Myers?
Right,
I remember when
right.
He used to point like that, he pointed at
We got Dusty Rhodes. We got Pak Song Nam, one of the greatest Korean wrestlers ever to come to the United States. You got a guy, Mr. Uganda.
Is he from Uganda?
No, he was Cyclone Negro, put a mask on and wrestled for a while.
You could have been Mr. Uganda.
But I wasn't.
He still could be.
And the most notorious bail bondsman of them all, the Missouri Mauler, who wasn't a great wrestler, but he would knock your head right off.
And he was Jody Hamilton's brother. Am I right or wrong? Yes, I am right. Right.
Don't go away. Stay tuned for this great match back in the day.
Was I right?
Correct.
Good.
Hey, welcome back, and you're getting ready to see six classic wrestlers, names unbelievable in the wrestling industry.
Huge names.
During the break, Randy mentioned that he had had a great match with Killer Carl Cox.
Well, it was a great match for me, not necessarily for him, but he was a cool dude. My second match in the business, came over, shook my hand. I was green as broccoli, green as asparagus, and he led me through the match, and he called me by my first name, and props to Killer Carl Cox and his family. I think you're a cool dude.
Hey, that's great. And I'll tell you, I had some serious battles with Pak Song. I mean, I used to stand and watch him break those bricks and stuff with his hands. And when he put the claw on you, and when Steve, as a matter of fact, he broke your leg.
Yeah, I sure did. That was 1978. The match that brings back memories to me, though, is a Missouri Mauler. You remember how when you were a young guy, if you got pulled in there and you had to wrestle a Missouri Mauler, the only thing you could think of is you were going to have a headache after it was all over. A brass knucks match I had with Missouri Mauler. One of the most devastating matches of my career, and I had nightmares about it for 20 years after it.
But what Steve's not saying is he hit Mauler so hard and so many times during this battle that they found the Missouri Mauler lost roaming around in the back of the Miami Beach Convention Center.
I'm going to have to give Mike some money for that.
Dude, I've been talking to my dad about Steve Keirn. He's the biggest cold brother that ever was.
Oh, come on, you're going to have to do better than that.
And then give it back to me.
Cool. Anyway, it's we're getting ready to see Killer Carl Cox, Dusty Rhodes, and Sonny Myers.
Would you train me?
Mr. Uganda, the Missouri Mauler. Six classic wrestlers. Stay tuned right now. Hey, welcome back, and I hope you enjoy the matches that you see when there's no narration, because I do that on purpose when I'm putting these shows together. I want you to feel like you're in the crowd. You're at the Armory in 1974 watching these matches, to feel the excitement from the people, to hear them screaming and yelling, to hear the noise in the ring. Not with music, not with somebody talking over it. It's done like that on purpose to give you a different feel.
Tell you what, when you just said that, it just gave me a throwback deja vu, because I remember after the ball games, all the guys would just like race to the Armory over there to watch the matches. We'd get in right before the main event, and naturally it was all sold out, and we'd have to get way at the top. And that was the feeling I just got. Look at the chills right there.
You know what it brings back to my mind is that this is authentic film that can't be seen anyplace else, because it's in your possession. You own this film, and the only place any wrestling fans that are diehard fans are going to be able to see this classic video and classic film with sound or no sound is right here.
Well, Steve, you're exactly right. You know, it's part of all of our history. That's why we are excited about it. That's why we enjoy bringing you this show, because we lived it, we've done it, and we want you to
experience it. Shake your hand right now, because for the first time in the history of life, somebody can't be bought out. This guy right here owns the tapes, and he's going to send them out to you through the video scope for all to enjoy. There's a price for everybody except for Mike Graham, and I think that's cool.
That is cool.
But right now, the show is over. There's many more to come. Come back next week, and nobody can say it better than Randy.
Woo! Yeah! This is the deal!
Speak Gordon Soley saying, so long from the Sunshine State.